But from the point of view of sysadmins, is it okay for the screen sharing? Do you see my screen?
Yes, we do. And by the way, this meeting is going to be recorded. So for those who do not want to be on the recording, just be a passive listener. Thank you.
Okay. Today, I will present you Ansible, but for the point of view of the sysadmin, it means the persona I will try to play today is I am expert in sysadmin, but in classical sysadmin, where with SSH and, for example, Bash script and Python script. And I will try to explain to you why it could be interesting for you to use Ansible and how to have some gain in time with Ansible. First, I present me quickly. I am an open source contributor more than 20 years, and I have worked for several startups and successful scale-ups more than 15 years. I am also one of FOSDEM managers. FOSDEM is the biggest open source community in Europe with a lot of people. And you can participate remotely each year on our website, fosdem.org. And I'm working at IBM as an open source architect to help clients to migrate and maintain open source architectures. And last but not least, as a hobby, I'm doing a few popularization of science in an association with a critical thinking approach. Okay, donc the red line today is to speak about the task of classical sysadmin. If you are a sysadmin, you already know how to connect remotely on Linux server with SSH. Normally, you should know how to install manually software with apt or yum or DNF with the latest version of Red Hat Enterprise Linux. You know how to edit configuration files with Nano or Vim. Certainly, especially if you are several person is working hard working in on several computers, you have some documentation written in a wiki. And for most of them, they have also knowledge to write some Bash or Python scripting for automation. Normally, without you can do your job very well with in your sysadmin role, and most sysadmin doing that every day. But we have some challenges with this approach to do manual operations. The first main challenge, if you have some experience to maintain at least 10 servers at the same time, is how to avoid small differences between servers. Why you have some differences between servers? Simply because if you are installing a software on one server and you're installing the same piece of software on another server 6 months later, if you do a yum update, you might have some version differences, and it might be a nightmare to find a bug simply because you have a very small difference in a configuration file or the version of the software, or you have forgotten to install a specific library. The second challenge with this pattern is how to reinstall a server at the same state. Especially if you are using a public repository like npm or PyPI for Python. Another challenge is how to who has modified this element. It's complicated to have some traceability. especially if you have a team of sysadmins, because you can have somebody is doing a modification and other person in the team are not aware about this modification. And last but not least, how to have an history of modifications. Because you have no, except the bash history, but the bash history, you have only the list of commands, and you have some cases where the history is not stored inside the bash history. Voilà. Alors, with Ansible, we can have some solution for that. But before to speak about Ansible itself, I would like to speak with you why to use Ansible instead of to simply continue to use Bash or Python script, because at the end, Ansible playbooks are source code. Why you could simply use Python scripts and avoid to use Ansible? Because the main challenge is with Ansible playbooks, you need to learn a new syntax based on YAML, contrary to Bash or Python, where it's a complete programming language you can use for everything. Nevertheless, you have three main advantages to use Ansible instead of to write custom Python scripts. The first one, the syntax is simplified to write Ansible playbooks compared to Python or Bash, where it's complete programming language. The second point is you have a lot of dedicated modules ready to use to do some high-level operations, contrary to in Python or Bash, you need to write 100 of lines to have the same the same features. And last but not least, with Ansible is written in Python, it means you can embed Ansible directly in your Python code. And with that, you can have the best of both worlds, use regular Python code, and you can embed Ansible and launch Ansible modules through your Python code. It can be a way to use Ansible instead of to use Ansible playbooks. Alors, the first main advantage of Ansible is very, very simple to install Ansible. Most of the time, it will be only one command line with yum or pip. Pip is the package installer of Ansible. And with this application, after you install Ansible, Ansible simply use SSH connections, like as you, when you connect on a server. And you have two main commands with Ansible. You have Ansible itself and Ansible playbook. And to start to use Ansible, it's very simple. You need only to start with one file, hosts. And the host files is a text file, very simple to understand. Each line is a server, and you can put some specific variables, for example, the IP address, in case of the name you put inside the file is not possible to use DNS to find the server. And you can put also the username to connect to the server and the port also. And you can define categories or groups of servers. For example, here I define two servers where it's a database server. And okay, now it's lifetime. For your information, the slides will be available after this talk, and you can reuse. And in case of you have some questions, you can interrupt me, and by chat or in live as you like. Donc here on my computer, I have simply install Ansible. Donc with yum install Ansible, simply like that. I am on Linux. After that, I have several Ansible commands. I have several commands of Ansible, but you have two main commands, Ansible and Ansible playbooks. Ansible playbook is a command to launch playbooks. I will show you after. And you have a command, Ansible. And the Ansible command is a tool to launch a command line, a module, an Ansible module, on several servers. I show you right now. Here, simply to show you, okay, Ansible is installed. And I need my host file. Look, I have the host file here. And on this laptop, I have two virtual machines. I can show you. Here, it's I have two virtual machines. The first virtual machine is here, host 0. And I have a second virtual machine, host 1. And I can connect on them through SSH. Voilà, I'm connected on the machine. And you can type command line Linux as usual. And now I have my Ansible command. I have my inventory file, donc the text file I have just here. And in Ansible, you have the notion of modules. I will explain later. For now, I use the first main module named shell. Shell is simply an Ansible module to launch a command on several servers. And as arguments, I put, okay, I want to launch a uname dash A. This command means simply to show the kernel version. And here is the list of servers I want to execute the command. Here I've put all as all servers. And when I launch the command, you can see on host 1 and host 0, the result of the command. And I can do that for other commands like if, for example, to see the space available on each server. Look, here, it's already a gain of time without very few changes from my sysadmin habits. I need simply Ansible. I need this host file, but in Ansible, it's not mandatory. In case of you already have an inventory system like in VMware or in the cloud, you have several plugins in Ansible to read these remote inventories. And after that, I launch the module and I have the result. I have another interesting module named setup where I can retrieve a lot of information about the server itself. Look, it's a lot of information. For example, the Python version, the distribution, the CPU, the boot image. And these value will be available inside the Ansible playbooks. Look, here, another example to execute a module. Here, it's the copy module. Look, here, the same thing. I put my inventory host file. I put the name of the module, copy. And I put the arguments of the module. Here, src as source for the file I want to copy and the destination. And simply to show you, I connect on server. I have no host2 file. And now I launch the command. And I can launch on all servers, for example. Execute. Voilà. And here I have the result of the execution where he has copied the file. Now, if I check, my file has been copied. And about the argument itself, it's pretty simple to find. In fact, you have a very well documented modules in Ansible in the official documentation. And here you have thousands of modules for a lot of elements to manage several clouds, to manage a lot of elements of your servers and also for your network devices, containers. And for example, if I check, looking for a copy, the copy module. Voilà. Donc, here it's the copy module. Voilà. And inside the documentation, I have always a small synopsis to explain the purpose of the module. And I have all parameters I can use. Donc, for example, here for copy module, I can put a checksum to be sure I copy the right file. I have a destination. The rights also, the owner, I can change the owner during the copy. And last but not least, you have always examples at the end of the file where you can take some inspiration when you want to do something special with your module. And okay, now we have an idea of what is the Ansible module and how to use the Ansible command itself. Now I will show you One of killer features is the idempotent. What does it mean? It means if I launch a module 10 times, only the first time it will modify the server. It means it's not a problem to launch Ansible command or Ansible playbook because at the first time it will do the modification, but after the other attempts, the server won't be modified. I show you, for example, I re-execute the same command, and here Ansible detects automatically is the same file, and as you can see, I don't have the same color because here, this color means, I don't know if you see very well my text. Here, you can see the first time I execute, I see it's changed. And now I execute the second time. And the second time, okay, it's green because Ansible does no modification at all. And in case of somebody else do a mistake and remove my file. Okay, I remove the file here. Okay, I have no file anymore. And now I relaunch the command. Now we can see on the first, on host one, I have no modification. On the second server, I have a modification. And now, if I re-execute again, both files are okay. And in case of another sysadmin cause a modification in the file itself, random characters, and now execute again. Voilà. Here, Ansible with only one simple line with the module copy. Copy module has a built-in feature to do a checksum between the both files, detect a modification, and replace my modified file with the original file. Now I can relaunch again. It's green. And here, if I check, my modification is gone. This notion is very important in Ansible. I don't know if somebody has a question. Otherwise, I will continue. Okay, I continue. Okay, I can, as you show you, I can relaunch the command. Voilà. Donc, now I have the command, Ansible command. And in fact, Ansible playbook is simply a YAML file where you can note, you can write all modules you want to execute and in which order you want to execute the Ansible modules. Okay, I show you here. This is its command line I have used, the equivalent in Ansible playbook is this piece of text. This command line or this text are equivalent. It does the same action. And I can show you. Okay, I have an example here with a task to execute. And voilà. And to be able to launch the Ansible playbook, it looks like the Ansible command, but with some few differences. I still have the inventory file I need to pass in parameters. But for the servers I want to execute now, I have a new parameter dash L, and I have the my YAML file. I'll show you directly. Voilà. Donc, here, as you can see, the Ansible playbook has copied the file. Here, voilà. It's a new name. I've put a new name, host4, simply to show you the difference. And I have the exact same result as before. Instead of, I have directly, it's okay or not okay. And I can put dash V as verbose for more information. Here, I retrieve the same value as before. Or if I need to debug, I can put several V. And here I can, here I have the full full process, full logs with all actions made by Ansible, the SSH connection, the data used, Here is simply when you have bugs, you want to debug your Ansible playbook, but here it's enough. And again, now I have auth 4, and if I modify auth 4, I launch again. Voilà, I see auth 0 has been changed. And if I re-execute again, voilà, nothing has changed. Alors, about these Ansible playbooks, you have some few good practice.
There's a question. A question, Ludwig. So why we defined DB? So the part of your hosts that you grouped as DB, why did you use this in the command line? Maybe you want to show this again?
Here it's simply because I have put in my host file DB, simply like that. I could put, in fact, all as before. And simply to show you the difference. Simply to show you the difference, I can take, I don't know if it's enough big. Voilà. And put, for example, simply for example, for the example, I put observer to say something. And now, if I put DB here, I have only you see, I have only one host, the host 0. And if I put if I put again all here, I have the full all servers normally.
And there was also a second question. If you can overwrite the host of the playbook file on the command line, if you can overwrite this.
Could you repeat? Can I override host of? But you can select another host file. Here, you can have several host files. Pretty simple. And in fact, another thing, you have DB and web servers, and here when I execute. It executes only on DB servers. It's why I don't have host one. But here, if I put inside the playbook, you need to define the list of hosts can be where this task can be executed. And now, if I put voilà. Donc here. I have in my playbook file, I have selected all servers can execute this task. And now it's OK, I can execute on only one server. Voilà. OK, I continue. OK, you have some good practices with Ansible. It's not mandatory, but it's a good practice to have the full advantage to use Ansible. The first one, the most important, is to store your Ansible playbooks ideally inside a source repository system like Git, inside GitHub or GitLab. And without, it will be easier to collaborate with several persons as developers does. with the GitHub or GitLab interface. The second one, very important, is try to avoid the much as possible manual modifications on server, because with that, but you might have some differences between what you have inside the playbook and Ansible playbooks and what you deploy on the server concretely. But the good thing is you can do easily a phase in, phase out of your practice. It means you it's not like other configuration system. With Ansible, you can introduce Ansible in an environment where everybody are doing manual actions, and you can do a phase out of manual actions and phase in with Ansible playbooks. And the idea at the end is to do everything on with Ansible playbooks, but you can mix the manual approach and Ansible playbooks, because especially if you have 100 or 1,000 of servers to manage, it's impossible to switch from manual approach to Ansible playbooks in 1 day or 1 week. And last but not least, it can be a good practice to centralize the execution with a tool like Ansible Tower, AWX, but you can use also GitLab Runner, GitLab CI, or GitHub Actions. Why this is important? Simply because it's important to have an history of execution and not only an history of source code. Because with Git, you have the history of the source code of your playbooks, but you have no idea when the Ansible playbooks has been executed. Contrary to with AWX or GitLab CI, where you centralize the execution and you have the history of executions of your playbooks. Yes, and it's true, it's a GitOps approach. Voilà. Donc, to finish, I have started this presentation with 4 questions, and now we should have a better idea how is the answer of Ansible to answer to these questions. Donc, the first question was how to avoid small differences between servers, but it's with Ansible playbooks. If you execute only Ansible playbooks to modify your servers, you reduce the risk of differences. Again, if you build your servers from scratch directly with an Ansible playbook, but you can reinstall easily at the same state as before. And to track who has modified what, you have Git plus AWX, and you have also an history of modifications. You have several interesting Ansible tutorials. Alors, I recommend especially the two first. Alors, the second one is very interesting in case of it's complicated for you to install something somewhere on your environment, because here you can test and play with Ansible directly with your web browser, and you have a few scenarios, and I can show you. It's a tutorial, but you have a command line. I show you just after the time to prepare the environment. And the second tutorial I recommend for you is this tutorial, because here the interesting this tutorial is the learning curve is very smooth. It means you each step you have 13 steps, and each step are very simple. The step zero, they recommend to use Vagrant, but at least for me, you don't need to use Vagrant. You simply set up two virtual machines with SSH installed on it and put your SSH key on it. I recommend you to use SSH keys, by the way. And after each step, you have an extra action to do. Donc, the first step is simply to create the host file, like I did. Donc, you play with host file, with an example, and you have an example with the ping command. Yeah, ping command is simply a very simple module, simply to check if possible to connect on the server. And step by step, you will have more information at one moment, and at what moment you start to have a very small Ansible playbook, and at the end, the true power of Ansible are Ansible roles, and I can show you at the end your Ansible repository should look like that with roles, and inside the roles you have a lot of elements. You can see you can find all your tasks. And here, in fact, an Ansible role is simply a way to split easily your set of tasks, simply like that. But this tutorial, the learning curve is very smooth. Voilà. And the other tutorials are also good, but the approach is more classical. And especially for roles, you need to play with it. It's not so complicated, but it's important to start with all-in-one file. To start with only one file, and after a while, you will understand the interest to split in several small files your big Ansible playbook file. Voilà. Do you have any questions? Everybody is sleeping? Are sleeping?
So there are none in the chat, but someone is typing. So maybe give it a second. I see two people typing. And whether you can share your presentation.
Yes.
Is there a GitHub link inside? You can put it in the public chat?
It's not yet pushed, but yes, I will publish the link inside the Meetup conversation.
Okay. And another compliment for the very nice presentation. Not sleeping, thanks. Probably astonished.
No problem.
Okay.
I don't know if somebody else has another question.
And we have a person typing. Martin is typing. So which resources, maybe modules, do you mean that? Do you recommend for network automation?
You have some tutorials for network automation itself. But I recommend first maybe to understand pretty well some concepts inside Ansible playbooks. And after you have, let me check, it's here. Voilà, here. Well, depends on the. Alors, I know on the internet you have some specific modules, specific tutorials, especially for the routers. I have used that, but in fact, it's pretty simple. About when you know what you want to do with the router. You simply have to follow the the documentation. Donc, for example, to configure iOS, donc iOS for Cisco, donc on Cisco routers, the operating system named iOS, you have a lot of modules to configure and provision Cisco routers. It's but from the point of view of Ansible itself, it's the same way as any module. Donc here, for example, it's the module to manage static IP routes inside Cisco. And for me, I like a lot to see examples. For me, it's more explicit to see a few examples. And after, I check all parameters in case of I need something special. And voilà. Alors, with Ansible, alors works on, to my knowledge, the main transport is SSH for Linux server. But from a while now, you can also manage Windows. And here it uses, I don't remember the name. You have a specific, it's not SSH, it's, what's the name again? The equivalent of SSH on Windows. PowerShell. It's done through PowerShell instead of SSH. And but you can administrate in the same way your Windows server. But for Linux server, it's through SSH. But for example, AWS, here it's these modules are not using SSH, but are using REST API of AWS. Donc here, it depends on the module are you using. But again, for routers, maybe SSH, but I think it's using something special. I don't remember the name. Yeah, thank you. WinRM for remote management. Yeah.
Another question that came up is whether you use, why you use version 2.9 of the docs, and is it because you use Red Hat Enterprise Linux, or probably because it's a default? No. So if you open it, I think
it's a default. Yeah, it's a default. I think if I check on PyPI.org, look, PyPI.org is the Python package repository. If I check on Ansible, I'm a little bit surprised about the version, but apparently it's 5 now. Okay. Yeah, no, it's seems the correct one. Yeah, yeah, it 2.9 was the default documentation version. Yeah. Let me check. Yeah, it's you have right. It's the version of Ansible inside Red Hat Enterprise Linux. Yeah, and you have some documentation about network automation here. And I recommend a lot the Ansible documentation. You have a lot of information on it. With great tutorials also inside. But you have a lot of information inside. It's why it can be good to start with a smaller documentation with a tutorial, outside a tutorial. Yes, it's true. It's Ansible Core. Yeah, now you have two main modules, Ansible Core and the Ansible with the extra modules. Depends on which support you want with Ansible. And we are doing some Ansible support at IBM and Red Hat, where we can provide consulting and how to use and do some architecture thinking with the clients to help them to deploy that correctly, especially to integrate that with DevSecOps, donc DevOps plus security, because it's pretty important, especially right now with Log4j problems.
Okay, are there any other questions or from the audience? Otherwise, I think, Ludwig, that's the end of your presentation. Am I?
Yeah. It's the end of presentation. I hope it was interesting for you. Don't hesitate to contact me through LinkedIn in case of you want some extra question or you have some challenges with Ansible. I will do my best to answer you, and I will put an update on the meetup website with the links, and I will publish also the link to the presentation on my LinkedIn page.
So I think you used Reveal.js, am I correct, for your presentation?
Yeah.
So. It's not a typical PowerPoint or PDF. It's a HTML generated presentation.
Yeah. And it's pretty cool, pretty simple to use, and possible to generate a PDF with it and integrate HTML, simply HTML, in fact, with my presentation.
Okay. So big thank you to you, Ludovic, also take the time and present Ansible with concrete examples, easy to follow. The audience is also happy. So unless there are no further questions, you heard from Ludovic, you will get the information on Meetup, on his LinkedIn. And if not, just contact me and I will forward this to Ludovic. So I will write the name. It's reveal.js. It's a JavaScript library. Yeah, exactly.
I put also to keep in touch. I can put also my LinkedIn profile.
Yeah, that would be perfect. So your contact details are also shared.
Yeah.
Then thank you all for joining for this great presentation, and have a nice evening later.